Fetal gastroschisis is an anomaly that we observe in fetuses that has to do with the abdominal wall. What we find is that in certain fetuses, the abdominal wall doesn't form completely, and there ends up being a defect or hole right next to the umbilicus, usually on the right side of the umbilicus, or belly button, and that allows intestine or other viscera to actually herniate outside of the abdominal cavity into the amniotic space. Usually it's only intestine, but sometimes there'll be other organs there. And the cause is not yet really known, but we do have some epidemiologic understanding of what seems to be associated with it. For example, young maternal age, as well as smoking, are heavily associated with this defect. And we believe that there is likely a toxin in the environment that contributes to it, and it may be more than one toxin. We have noticed an increase in this disease around pesticides and also around the use of vasoconstrictive drugs. Gastroschisis generally is a very well-tolerated defect that has an overall survival around 98%. The issues we run into during pregnancy generally occur later on at around the 36 to 38 week point. We do find that on average these babies tend to deliver a little bit prematurely, and some of them will be a bit small compared to normal babies that are developing. We tend to err on the side of watching these babies more carefully than we would babies without such an anomaly in order to make sure that all of their biophysical parameters are optimally maintained and that we can intervene and deliver earlier if need be. In terms of the mode of delivery, we haven't found any evidence to suggest that from the perspective of the gastroschisis, a cesarean section is indicated for this condition. And that's very important because a lot of the people that have gastroschisis are young and it's their first pregnancy, and we'd like to have as little morbidity for the mom as possible. And so that's quite important. Obviously a C-section could be indicated for other reasons that have to do with obstetrics or any other indication, but just from the perspective of the gastroschisis, a C-section is not mandated. Gastroschisis is treated after the baby is born by having an extremely coordinated and multidisciplinary team approach. Here at the Children's Center, the neonatologists attend the birth, and the first step once the baby is delivered is to make sure that the baby is breathing appropriately and that the heart is maintaining its circulation appropriately. But then we move on to the gastroschisis specific evaluation. And the primary goal there, and this is all sort of happening at the same time, is to make sure that the bowel is well protected. And the way that we do that is by placing the bowel and actually the lower extremities of the baby and lower abdomen in a plastic bag that both allows the bowel to have a barrier between it and the outside world, and also preserves heat and fluid so that the baby doesn't get dehydrated and doesn't get cold. And then our pediatric surgery team comes in and makes sure that the bowel is oriented correctly and is ready for a primary closure. Gastroschisis in general, as compared to another abdominal wall defect, omphalocele, is much more isolated. Generally, in about 85 to 90% of the cases, it's the only defect that the baby has. We are able to treat that defect in almost all cases and have the baby go on to live a pretty normal life without any consequences. However, in a small percentage, about 10 to 15%, there are other anomalies. The most frequent other anomaly is something called an atresia. That's when there's discontinuity in the bowel, and that may be because of improper blood supply to the intestine as it's floating in the amniotic cavity, or because the ring around which inside of which the bowel actually is herniating gets too tight and cuts off the blood supply or the blood that's returning to the baby. In those cases, what we do is we wait until we think the baby is stable, and then we perform abdominal surgery here at the Children's Center to reconnect a bowel that's interrupted or fix whatever other defect may be present. So the good news about gastroschisis is that overall survival is excellent here in the United States and also here at the Children's Center. The survival rates that we have seen are basically around 98 to 99%. So mortality is really not an issue. In terms of the way the belly button looks with our new closure technique using the sutureless repair, we have found that the belly button looks excellent. In the past, whereas the belly buttons didn't look that good, now they look great. What we do find in general is that these babies do have some degree of what we call bowel dysmotility. They will have either a little more constipation or a little more diarrhea than you would expect in a normal child. And we think that has to do with some kind of injury sustained from the intestine being on the outside of the body during pregnancy. We have seen no evidence of any neurocognitive defects, and basically these kids are able to thrive and grow as completely normal kids. What we do is we give the baby some pain medicine and make sure that the baby's comfortable, and then we very carefully, under sterile conditions, put all of that intestine that's on the outside into the baby's abdomen very carefully, with the goal of not creating any damage and not providing too much stretch on the abdominal wall. We do generally get all of it back in on that first go, and then once we've done that and put it back in an orderly fashion, we put over a special bandage that allows the abdominal wall to essentially heal over the viscera that we've put back in. And that works great, and it ends up with an excellent cosmetic result. Sometimes we'll have to delay that procedure a little bit if the abdominal contents won't fit, if the intestine won't fit into the abdominal cavity, because we don't want to push it and possibly compromise the bowel in any way. And so in that situation, we'll use a spring-loaded silo that we can put the intestine into, and actually will stretch the abdominal wall, and over a period of days allows the intestine to descend into the abdominal cavity. And that works quite well and still allows us to perform a sutureless repair. In some cases where it's more complicated and the intestine is either stuck to the abdominal wall or there is a large amount of intestine that's compromised, we'll actually do an operation right away in the operating room where we will address what other defects there are in the intestine and also close the abdominal wall with sutures. That leads to a slightly less optimal cosmetic result, but we pride ourselves on making it look as good as possible. Yeah.